It's okay. Hot. First of all, I'd like to welcome all of our members and our distinguished panel of experts to today's hearing focused on materiel reset. I wanted at the outset apologize to both of you for the delay, and thank you for being patient with us as we work through these votes that we had on the floor. And I want to thank our witnesses for being with us this afternoon. General Mason, I understand this is your first time testifying in your new capacity as the Deputy Chief of Staff of the Army for Logistics, and we want to welcome you and look forward to your service in that position. And we also understand, General Panner, that this is likely your last time to testify before this subcommittee before your retirement. And we just want to tell you what an honor it is to have you here, and thank you for the honorable service that you've given to this country and the service that you've rendered to our nation. I believe it's important that you are all here with us today. Resetting our force is a strategic imperative and one that will require continued commitment from this subcommittee and this Congress beyond combat operations. In light of shrinking defense budgets, the Budget Control Act's looming sequestration, and the administration's announcement of an accelerated drawdown in Afghanistan, I believe this hearing is very timely. Last year, we spent a great deal of time exploring our current state of readiness and discussing how we remain prepared to meet the challenges we're likely to face in the future. Time and again, we heard of a force that General Breedlove described as being on the ragged edge. We learned that one of the major drivers behind this degraded force was a lack of materiel readiness. Today, we again explore readiness, this time in the context of reset and its importance to ensuring a capable future force. Complicating this effort is the reduction of $754 billion in Department of Defense 10-year budget, leading the DOD to cancel many of its most advanced systems, like the CGX Next Generation Cruiser Program, the F-22, and the Army's Future Combat System. DOD has also made tough decisions on force structure and civilian personnel, shrinking the Marine Corps by more than 25,000 Marines, the active Army by 72,000 soldiers. In short, this means that resetting the force is now more important than ever. The administration is arguing that we can afford a smaller force, one with less capacity, as long as we have a more capable force. Let's be clear that failure to reset the force undermines this position and will leave us with a smaller and less capable force. If we do not get this right, the implications will be far-reaching and long-lasting. Many tough decisions still lie ahead, and I remain concerned that because the department has not begun planning for a possible sequestration, we only have a small sense of how truly catastrophic sequestration could be. We all have a responsibility to ensure our men and women in uniform are given the tools necessary for the job we've asked them to do. I look forward to learning more about reset and its importance to the warfighter. And I'd now like to turn to my friend and ranking member, Madeline Bordallo, the gentlewoman from Guam, for any remarks she may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, General Mason, General Panter. We all appreciate your service, and we look forward to your testimonies this afternoon. I want to congratulate you, General Mason, on your promotion, and also to you, General Panter, good luck as you enter into retirement. Today, we explore the issues and the challenges surrounding the reset of Army and Marine Corps equipment after more than a decade of war. We have searched hundreds of thousands of pieces of equipment from units and depots in the United States to locations across the Middle East in support of operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. Now that the war in Iraq is over, we are still dealing with the challenges of moving equipment from locations in Kuwait back to units who need this equipment for training and to perform new missions. So it is important for our committee members to understand the challenges with returning this equipment from Iraq to units at home. How do the Army and the Marine Corps prioritize equipment reset among many competing interests and units, from home station units to foreign military sales, and what is the underlying strategy? I am concerned that National Guard units in the United States will end up with significant equipment shortfalls and thus hinder their ability to respond to domestic homeland defense requirements. And how is this specific concern being addressed, especially by the Army? And I also hope that General Panter can elaborate on the Marine Corps process for reset and how they are addressing readiness issues with the third MIF. As we pivot to the Asia-Pacific region, it is more important than ever that we make the third MIF whole again and ensure that they have the proper equipment to meet current and emerging requirements in this theater over the coming years. In terms of whether to repair, rebuild, or replace, how do you assess what equipment now being used in Afghanistan is appropriate for the challenges that exist in the Asia-Pacific region? Additionally, our hearing will explore some of the challenges involved with retrograde of equipment from Afghanistan and its return to the United States for reset. Given the inability to move equipment across Pakistan ground routes, how is the department posturing itself to ensure equipment can flow by strategic airlift through the Northern Distribution Network? The FY13 President's budget request outlines some significant changes to the Air Force's strategic and tactical airlift capabilities. I am concerned what impact some of these changes will have on our ability to move equipment out of Afghanistan in a timely fashion. And we must understand that the retrograde and the reset of equipment from Afghanistan is going to be vastly different endeavor than the reset of equipment from Iraq because of the transportation challenges and the lack of a holding area such as we had for Iraq with Kuwait. It is important for members of our committee to understand this important distinction as we assess the adequacy of budgets and the strategic value of recent budgetary recommendations of Congress. And I also hope our hearing will make clear the further complication and the challenges posed by ever-increasing gas prices, especially given our reliance on airlift for reset in Afghanistan. I know that tomorrow we will explore the issue of alternate energy and its potential benefit to rising gas prices. However, I do remain concerned that if we don't continue efforts to look at alternate energy for operational purposes, we will be assuming even more significant risk in reset in Afghanistan. So I hope that our witnesses can touch on this matter in their testimony as well. And I also hope our witnesses can comment on what is being done at our Army and Marine Corps depots to sustain workload over the coming years as we continue to reset equipment coming out of Iraq and Afghanistan. And again, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I look forward to our witnesses' testimony and our question and answer period.
Thank you, Madeline, for those remarks. As we discussed prior to the hearing, I'd like to dispense with the 5-minute rule for this hearing and depart from regular order, so that members may ask questions during the course of the discussion. I think this will provide a roundtable type forum and will enhance the dialogue on these very important issues. We'd like to proceed with standard order for members to address the witnesses. However, if any member has a question pertinent to the matter being discussed at that time, please seek acknowledgement and wait to be recognized by the chair. We plan to keep questioning to the standard 5 minutes. However, I don't want to curtail productive dialogue. I believe we can do this and still ensure each member has the opportunity to get his or her questions asked. If we get bogged down, the chair will ask members to hold further discussion until the first round of questioning is complete. I ask unanimous consent that for the purposes of this hearing, we dispense with the 5-minute rule and proceed as described, and without objection, we will do so. At this point in time, we'd like to move to our opening statements. General Mason, we normally move from left to right, but since this is a bipartisan subcommittee, we can go from right to left, and I'll leave it up to whichever one of you guys want to go first, and you can decide among yourselves, and then we look forward to hearing from you.
Okay. I will go. Okay. Well, good afternoon, Chairman Forbes and Ranking Member Bordeaux, other members of the committee. I'll follow your guidance, sir, and rather than read my written statement, I'll ask it to be submitted for and accepted into the record. I would like to highlight 3 key points. First and foremost, we've accomplished much in the past 8-10 years on reset. We've met our Iraq drawdown goals, and we've surged to meet the reset requirements thanks to your unwavering support and the support of our citizens. And we've infused significant readiness into our fleets, particularly our tracked fleet and our wheeled vehicle fleet. Second point is much to be done yet. Reset is certainly the true cost of war. It's not about when the last unit gets back, it's when the last piece of equipment gets back and we get it into the depot and get it repaired. And as Ms. Bordeaux said, Afghanistan is a different challenge from Iraq, and perhaps we'll discuss that in more detail. It's a tough challenge, it's a landlocked country, the enemy is significant there, so we're working our way through the retrograde operations out of Afghanistan. And we will need funding for 2 years once all the equipment gets back, and I'd ask for your support of that, certainly. Thirdly, the organic industrial base. We're committed to having a viable organic industrial base. We're proud of the work that our depots and arsenals have completed in the last 8-10 years. They've been very, very, very busy. The workload will certainly decline as our operations now have drawn down in Iraq and will draw down in Afghanistan in 2014 and beyond. But we're committed to keeping that core capability that provides us that war-fighting capability to expand to future contingencies. And then finally, I would thank you for your awesome support of our soldiers, our 1.2 million Army soldiers and their families, active, reserve, and National Guard. And I want to thank you for your continued support of our reset operations, which is so critical to the readiness of America's Army. And I look forward to your questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, General. General Panner.
Thank you, Chairman Forbes, Ranking Member Bodao, and other committee members. Thank you for allowing me to appear today, and for sake of time, I'll keep my remarks very short because the questions are probably more important than my opening statement. As you may know, today we have over 27,000 Marines deployed throughout the world, with 20,000 in Afghanistan. It's with your continued support to our Marines and their families that our Corps has maintained our role as the nation's expeditionary force in readiness. On behalf of our Commandant, our Marines, and our family members, thank you sincerely. We were redeployed out of Iraq in the winter of 2009. We completed the last depot reset action at our depots in December of this last year. So that is an example of the time that's needed from redeployment to getting the equipment through the depots. We're now focused on the retrograde as decisions are made of equipment coming out of Afghanistan. Our current OEF ground equipment reset strategy that was signed 1 January 2012 is grounded on lessons learned from Iraq and the experiences we had there related to retrograde and reset. It's written from an enterprise approach to ensure that we send the equipment to the right place the first time as best as we can. Lastly, much like General Mason mentioned, as long as we have Marines and soldiers in harm's way, we need continued OCOS support. Related to the equipment piece, it is when the last piece leaves Afghanistan, and we'll need 2 or 3 years to reset and fix our Marine Corps for the next contingency that might arise in defense of our nation. Thank you, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you both, and as I mentioned at the outset, we appreciate the service you've both given to our country. We want to thank not only both of you for what you've done, but also as representatives of the men and women who serve under you for the great job that they do in defending this country and keeping us free. I'm going to defer my questions till the end because I know our members have very busy schedules. I want to make sure they can get their questions in. So I'm going to ask the ranking member now to ask any questions that she has, and I yield her as much time as she needs.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and again, thank you to our witnesses. General Mason, can you further discuss for the committee how the Army is working to ensure that National Guard units back in the United States and the territories will receive equipment that is coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan? And further, can you elaborate on how the dual line and specific homeland defense mission equipment requirements will be met for National Guard units? I'm concerned that simply replacing equipment to fill the unit's modified table of equipment may miss a broader strategic imperative in where we place returning equipment and that it assumes significant risk for our National Guard. General?
Yes, ma'am. First off, I would say that the modernization and the fill of the equipment in the National Guard and the reserve component has significantly improved in the past 8-10 years. And because of the force deployments through Army Force Generation, those forces where in the past may not have been cascaded equipment, because they have deployed at ever-increasing rates, we have filled them with equipment. So that's key right off the bat. So they're in pretty good shape. Secondly, how do we make sure that they get that equipment? First off, we follow the Department of the Army Master Priority List that the G3 of the Army runs, gets the priorities from the Secretary and the Chief. And then we have a series of processes we run through. And one of them is called retrograde redistribution and reset. And it's R3. It's managed by the Army staff. I'm a member of that team. And what we do is we get all the requirements in from the different MACOMs, Army National Guard, USAR, rack and stack those based on the requirements, and then we cascade equipment to those units. It is based on R4 Gen. The next deploying unit is certainly going to get the latest equipment and get its entire fill. And we have aim points inside of the R4 Gen that says you'll get this readiness rate at return plus 90 days, return plus 180 days. And that is regardless of whether you're an active unit, National Guard, or Reserve unit. So they're all treated the same. And I would say that they're in very good shape.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you, General. This question, the next one, is for either of our witnesses. I hope you can expand on the issues surrounding the Northern Distribution Network. We know that it costs 2.8 times more to transport equipment through the Northern Distribution Network, but the Pakistan ground route is closed, so we are limited to options. Now, what risk in the proposed fiscal year 2013 budget and in the out years are we assuming by including these transportation costs in the OCO account? Whichever one.
Let me start and then you can pile on.
Sure.
Ray. Well, it is a concern of us, and it's a great concern. If we can't negotiate the reopening of the PAC GLOC, we have to default and rely on an NDN, Northern Distribution Network, or increase Strat airlift. Both are expensive propositions, mm-hmm. and it increases the deployment or redeployment. There's always that sensitive issue about the nations. We're dealing with the NDN network in itself. If for some reason that there's additional political strain related to these countries, that restricts the flow as well. Redeployment timelines, by not being able to use the PAC GLOC, will increase, along with, as you mentioned, ma'am, the cost as well. Despite all these challenges, though, TRANSCOM and CENTCOM, they do have mitigation strategies in place, and I'd be more than happy to talk about those as well. Quite a few of them, but negotiations are ongoing, as you know, to reopen the PAC GLOC. Ray, you want to pile on?
General?
Yes, ma'am. The PAC GLOC is critical, and it has been closed since November. The good news is, because of a lot of really great planning, our logistics situation is in very good shape. Fuel, we watch very closely. But back to the issue of retrograde out of Afghanistan. We're getting it out by air, so as aircraft come in, and we fill aircraft as they depart, both Air Force aircraft as well as commercial aircraft. So we're using every available aircraft to go back out again. The Northern Distribution Network, it's 3 to 4 times more expensive because it's 3 to 4 times lengthier. It's very complicated, a variety of different methods, rail, ferries, truck, so significant amount of changing and loading and unloading, so that adds to the cost as well. We're in the process right now with our partners at Transportation Command to run a series of proof of principles to do backhaul. Right now, everything that comes in through the Northern Distribution Network by ground comes one way and the trucks go back empty because of diplomatic clearances and we haven't really established that line. So we're in the process of doing that. We've got several hundred vehicles and containers that are moving back on the Northern Distribution Network, working through the diplomatic clearances. State Department is significantly helping us. The CENTCOM commander, TRANSCOM commander have visited those countries. So that's looking very good. Once we get that done, I think we'll begin to get the X-flow back out of the Northern Distribution Network. But that's going to rise the cost. So the PAC GLOC is still critical. We need to continue to negotiate and try to get that back open as well. We need both methods to get out of Afghanistan.
So you're on top of it then?
Yes, ma'am. The team is.
I have one final question, Mr. Chairman. This question, again, is for either of our witnesses. The FY13 President's budget calls for a reduction in the end strength of the Marine Corps and Army, as well as a force structure change in many of our services. What criteria are being used to determine what equipment presently used in Afghanistan will be needed for future forces? And further, how does our pivot to the Asia-Pacific region impact that assessment? I hope our witnesses can be specific about what types of equipment would be needed in the Asia Pacific as well as for the future forces broadly? So either one of you.
Ma'am, I'll start because, as you may well know, we completed our force structure review 18 months ago. It was a detailed and conscious look at what the Marine Corps would look like at post-OEF. We took it to 186.2 from 202,000 down to 186,002. And then further budget pressure caused us to take it a little bit farther to 182.1. We thought we have confidence that we have right-sized our Marine Corps at 182. We can still meet the national missions assigned to us. Related to reset, this 182 force, knowing what that is, has helped to inform what we're resetting to. Now, you also may know that we swung a lot of equipment when we got out of Afghanistan, out of Iraq, over to Afghanistan. In fact, 42% of the equipment set we brought over from Iraq into Afghanistan. That stuff has essentially has been in the fight for 10 years. Mm-hmm. We know what we're going to map that equipment back to. We're going to divest some of this equipment because it's worn out, or is combat losses, or is planned for foreign military sales. About 21% of that equipment set. So even though we are going down to 182 and we are divesting of some equipment, we know where we need to plug the gaps and holes to get the readiness of the force across the board back up.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am. Very similar to the Marine Corps. We are in the process of doing our force structure alignment. Decisions have not been made yet by the Secretary and the Chief. We're looking at restructuring our brigade combat teams to potentially a third maneuver battalion. We now have two maneuver battalions in each brigade. We're also looking at adding another engineer battalion. So that's going to drive the equipment we want to take out. But we're not waiting on that. We'll need all those types of equipment that are there. The question is the quantities of them. We know we're going to need MRAPs. We know we're going to need Humvees. We're going to need tactical vehicles, certainly all the helicopters that are there. So it's really focusing in on the quantities. The way we're managing that is we have a responsible retrograde task force headed up by a three-star, and he's our connection to the theater that's looking at, we send him the demand signal as to what we need out and when we need it, and we communicate that into the units. And so that's the priority we want to come back to the depots to get reset. Mm-hmm. In terms of your question in the Pacific, I think any battlefield we're going to go on, we're going to have an IED threat. So MRAPs are going to be as critical in that part of the world as they have been in the last 8 years in Iraq and Afghanistan. So one of the things we're doing is looking at our Army pre-positioned sets. The Chief and the Secretary have directed us to do a full worldwide review of all that, with the focus on the new national military strategy about, do we have the right amount in the Pacific? So potentiality for additional pre-positioned sets in the Pacific. Potentially training sets, our float brigade, which is called an Army Preposition Number 3. We have a light brigade and a sustainment brigade afloat. We may need to relook that for additional capabilities. So the equipment we take out of Iraq and Afghanistan, some of that will be placed against APS and will allow units then to rotate into the Pacific for training events or a contingency. Last thing is similar to General Panner, the divestiture. Those old systems that we no longer need, we're going to divest of those. And that will save us op-tempo and OMA dollars in the out years. And so only have the equipment we absolutely need. We don't need to have a bunch of equipment parked in motor pools that beyond our requirements. So we have a divestiture process we're going through as well.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Generals. And I yield back.
Thank you, Madeline. The gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Runyon, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman and gentlemen. Thank you for being here and your service. Going back to what Ms. Bordaya was saying a little bit about, obviously the northern route we're having to take out is obviously more expensive. To what degree does escalating fuel prices affect those estimates to actually go through that route? General Mason?
Yes, sir. Fuel prices are a driver for Transportation Command and Air Mobility Command. I don't have the exact dollar figures at my hand, but I can get those. The fuel prices is so dynamic up and down, and so Transcom has to pay those fuel prices. As you know, Defense Logistics Agency provides those. Normally, Defense Logistics Agency sets the price of fuel at the beginning of the year, and that stays for that entire year. But because fuel has been so dynamic, they've been given leeway by OSD to adjust those during the year. I think they've done at least one adjustment. By fixing at the beginning of the year, it allows the services to budget for that. I and the G4 pay for what's called second destination transportation charges. That's where a lot of the retrograde dollars for transportation is paid through. So I watch it very closely. SDT, second destination transportation, is increasing. And if we don't get the PAC GLOC open, it's gonna expeditiously increase.
And that being said, not having that open, are there decisions that are made to maybe leave equipment behind that you wouldn't because it's just more cost effective just to leave it there and not pay the extra money to go out the other way?
Yeah, absolutely, sir. We in fact did that significantly in Iraq to the tune of about $1 billion that we through another number of mechanisms, either through excess defense articles or foreign excess personal property that we gave to the Iraqi army and police to get them up and running. We're not going to have the same opportunity in Afghanistan, we don't think, to be able to transfer large quantities of equipment to the Afghan police and military. They just don't have the infrastructure to accept that. So the vast majority of it we're going to have to pull out. There's a certain amount of equipment we will be able to either sell or donate to the Afghans, and some that's very old equipment will be divested through the Defense Reutilization and Marketing Service that DLA manages. They've got sites all over Afghanistan. Some of it they could sell locally. Some of it would be cut up for scrap that's battle damaged, and then they'll also ship some out. But I think the vast majority of what's in Afghanistan, because of the conditions there, we probably are going to have to move out of that country. Now, we could move it into the local, you know, countries that border it, and we're significantly looking at that, and there's opportunities there.
So you're saying there's not a significant chunk that you would consider leaving behind if you couldn't get it out through the South?
I don't think so at this point, not a considerable amount. There'll be some amount, but we think there's about 50,000 vehicles in Afghanistan. The vast majority of those will probably have to be retrograded, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir, if I may pile on that question a little bit. Our triage efforts in Afghanistan, which we're doing better this time from the lessons learned from Iraq, we're trying to send it to the right place the first time, to avoid some of the secondary transportation costs that General Mason talks about. Relating to, or fuel costs factored into the decision to leave a piece of equipment or to move it, it is considered, it most definitely considered. But I have to be straight up with you, if it's a hard requirement and there's not a production line and that piece of equipment is needed, we'll probably come to the decision that we'll send it where it's needed to enhance the readiness wherever that piece of equipment needs to go. Thank you.
Chairman, I yield back.
Thank the gentleman. The gentleman from New York is recognized for 5 minutes.
Well, thanks, Mr. Chairman, and great to be with the distinguished panelists today, too. Help me get caught up. There's three areas where I need the latest on where we're at. The first has to do with, as was mentioned earlier in the testimony, the new equipment we have, MRAP, for example, and then also there have been some transformation changes with regard to tables of organization. So how is that impacting now in the reset when you look at the installation? So motor pool sizes, barracks and all that, and certainly, you know, that can be a significant cost making that change in footprint back here in the United States.
I'll start off, okay. And then you pile on. If you, sir, you're absolutely right. We, after 10 years of combat, we have learned that some of our TEs, legacy TEs, are not what we need now or for the future. Good example, comm equipment, the requirement for comm equipment and ground tactical vehicles have increased. This is the nature of warfare now, distributed operations, where you have smaller units going out. They need that C2 capability. In fact, sir, you might not recognize a company command post today if you walk into it from your time. Tremendous enhancements. We have to adjust, and we have ongoing process of adjusting our TE. You're absolutely right. There is an impact at the installations on the back end of this stuff, and we're attempting to factor that in as we consider our MILCON projects.
Sir, we, as you know, we have modularized every unit in the Army. We finished that over the last basically 8 years, kind of started that in 01 and 02. And one of the centerpieces of that was the brigade combat team. We made it 100% mobile. We made it 3 days of supply, and that drove the truck requirement. So TRADOC, Training and Doctrine Command, is looking at what should the brigade of the future look like? Should we adjust it some? Does it really need to have 100% mobile? Could it be 80% mobile? Could it carry 2 days of supply and be sufficient? And we're finding that in combat, that's maybe more what we want. So TRADOC's working that through. They're modeling it. That'll drive the amount of trucks. So we're on iteration three of our tactical wheeled vehicle study. We've got about 260,000 vehicles, tactical vehicles. That's probably not what we're going to need in the out years. So that's part of that divestiture piece. So that'll drive down the amount of vehicles that take in the motor pool. That's one key piece there. At the installations, one of the things we're doing to optimize that is the directors of logistics that do the maintenance on our installations are now, they're currently OPCON, under the operational control of Army Material Command. They were under Installation Management Command, and in 1 October, they will be fully underneath AMC. So AMC will be able to workload the entire capability across the Army, the industrial and the sustainment maintenance from one location, and be able to see all that and then drive it towards effectiveness and efficiency. So that's moving out in a really good pace.
And so among the things being considered, I had heard, and I don't know this to be confirmed, but that there's consideration of changing the BCT, possibly another infantry battalion. And then, of course, that will have impacts on barracks and other things, certainly things we're going to have to watch in terms of costs.
Absolutely, sir. And we're working that very deliberately. The chief is looking at those standing up over time. You know, we've discussed taking down 8 brigade combat teams, but that's probably going to be the headquarters. Of course, the 2 brigades in Germany have already been announced. The other 4 brigades will be announced, I think, over the following years. So we're looking through, you know, that 3rd battalion. The leadership is convinced that's what we need for the warfighting capability. That's what the last 8 years have convinced us of, and certainly the engineers. So we're working our way through the MILCON. We clearly recognize that MILCON dollars are short, and so we're trying to do what we can on our installations. Our installations are in great shape, and it's a matter of shuffling around and working our way through there. So the team is working the numbers and the physics and geography of what we can do on our installations, and where do we put those brigades in that 3rd battalion.
Okay, very well. That certainly helps, and I appreciate the update. I'll throw these others out. I'm not sure I'm going to have time for it, but talked about OCO. And, you know, over the past decade, we had the REF and the RFI programs. I'd be interested to know how that bodes for the future. And then also, just a very simple question, we had assumptions on half-life of equipment, op-tempo hours before we would replace. Have we adjusted those assumptions? Because certainly that's going to have impact not only on current readiness, but also on procurement in the future. Has that changed based on the war?
Both the Rapid Equipping Force and Rapid Fueling Initiative have been great successes, both from the individual soldier and from the unit standpoint. So the Army is going through a process of where they're going to keep REF as a rapid acquisition process. My opinion is it's a capability we probably need to keep in the force and be able to rapidly get it through there. Back to the assumptions on the health of the equipment coming out of theater. Because we put significant special repair activities in theater, that has infused health into our vehicles and our equipment coming back. So some of this equipment's actually in better shape than we thought it was going to be. Some of it's worse. But generally, it's in pretty good shape because we put capability downrange, depot kinds of capability came out of TACOM and AMCOM and MICOM on the base. Fix as far forward as possible, and that's really made a big difference.
If I could answer this from a joint perspective, we have learned to maximize the use of joint capability better than we have in the past. The fixed forward concept, we rely on Army Material Command with the maintenance and repair of our equipment in Afghanistan, with the hope that we can vector some of that stuff back to home stations to avoid some of these extra transportation costs going through the depot. But what has changed and shifted, which I think is the basis of your question, is a reliance on DLA, things like AMC, things like maximize the use of that as a joint force. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman. Generals, thank you so much for your testimony. And now I've just got a few wrap-up questions if I could offer them to you and ask your response on them. The first thing, you've touched on this a little bit, but can you bring into focus for us the experience that you have learned from, or from your experience in Iraq, the lessons you've learned that have informed our retrograde operations in Afghanistan.
That's right. Reference what the lessons we learned from Iraq to transpose over to Afghanistan. Command and control, number one. You've got to have the right infrastructure with the right leaders. And I mentioned earlier about the Responsible Retrograde Task Force. General Dunwoody, the AMC commander, sent her deputy three-star into Kuwait to oversee that operation. And that provided the right level of leader and staff to synchronize that in coordination with Army Central Command. Also mentioned the retrograde reset and redistribution lists we use that determines where this equipment's going to go. So we provide those to the theater so they can see what their requirement is, and then AMC can see at the depot where it's coming. We put teams as far forward in the battle space as possible to help those units, because while they're retrograding, and we want them to focus on that, their main job is to conduct combat operations. So we're helping them with that. And it was recently approved to put the CENTCOM material retrograde element force of about 2,000 people into theater, and they'll focus purely every day on retrograde. The fourth thing I would say is that we need to provide and are providing to the theater good distribution instructions, as General Panner mentioned, telling them exactly where it needs to be shipped one so you can get the velocity in the system and use your transportation very effectively. So there's a series of lessons learned. I would say it's mainly command and control really turns the day.
Sir, if I could add to that, we view this, this is commander's business about accountability of equipment. And I think it's fair to say the United States Army sees it the same way. Something else we've done, we're more aggressive in assessing the condition of that equipment that we're about to return in Afghanistan than we did in Iraq. We shipped a lot of stuff from Iraq that probably was not worth shipping, that we'd been better off to divest it. We don't want to make those mistakes again. Decisions are being made from an enterprise perspective based on the commandant's priority, where to send this equipment. If it's to the three Marine Expeditionary Force in Okinawa, or if it's to Camp Pendleton in California, those decisions are being made early on, based on the need, based on the readiness condition of those units. We have data assist teams that are going forward and have been going forward to help cleanse the data so we have accurate records of what we have on hand, so we have a full visual of what's facing us to be sent home. Some of this is tactical. We told the commanders, we put a 10% tax on some of the forward operating bases. Roll 10% back, but don't put yourself at risk. But we know there's some excess stuff out there to try and get this mountain of things down. Every time there's an opportunity for opportune lift related to strat lift, we're trying to maximize that. We're triaging and putting equipment in marshaling areas, so if we get a chance to put something on the plane, we'll be in a position and we don't have to delay or we miss an opportunity for that. Last, the reset strategy that the Commandant signed off on 1 January, I think it links the tactical, the operational, and strategic aspect of this thing. So the Marines know that there's a bigger picture here. There's a bigger operation going on here, that whether they are assessing a piece of equipment in theater, fixing it, or whatever they're doing in theater, there's an end state to it. And the enterprise, from a larger perspective, we're attempting to get it where it's needed the most. Over. Thank you.
Chairman, if I could offer a couple of amplifying points and to jump on top of that. It is commander's business, and what General Scaparotti and the commanders downrange are saying is, Commander, you own everything on your forward operating base. That's your home, and so these containers that may have been there when you got there, you got to open them up. You got to look inside of them. And so it is about leadership. Secondly, it's about rehearsals. We just finished a major rehearsal rock drill, we call it, in Qatar with CENTCOM, USIFOR Alpha. I had a team there to talk through the processes of retrograde and getting the right equipment out there. So rehearsals, about every 6 months we've been doing those, and we may have to do those more often as we get closer to 2014. Thirdly, we have partnered with both the Army Audit Agency and GAO to provide us a third set of eyes, another, you know, outside set of eyes to watch us, see what we're doing, give us feedback. They're embedded in there with USA4 Alpha. We did that in Iraq. We found that very successful. The honest broker to say, you've got some problems here, and maybe you don't see them, maybe you've got some blind spots. And then finally, internally to me, I do a weekly video teleconference with theater every Wednesday morning, just did one this morning. I sit with RSENT and USA4 Alpha, United States Forces Afghanistan. We talk about where we're at, where are the gaps, where are the friction points, how can we help them, what help do they need from us? So those processes continue to be focused on that reset.
You know, we hear a lot about the term reset, but how important is reset to the readiness of the force from a strategic point of view, and how imperative is it that we make that investment and do it?
Sir, it's key and central. We've rode our equipment hard. It requires reset. The Congress have funded that over the last 10 years significantly, both in terms of maintenance, but also in terms of procurement for the battle losses. And we took significant battle losses in helicopters, tanks, Humvees, MRAP. So replacing that equipment is part of reset, and that's been magnificent. It's also provided us the opportunity to infuse technology. So when we bring something back to the depot, not only do we reset it in a sense of repairing what happened in theater, but if the latest technology is there, a new transmission, a new suspension system, and as you know, we've continued to put significant weight on our vehicles with armor. So being able to put the latest suspension system in to infuse that readiness. And right now, the age of our fleets, the track fleet is about 3 to 4 years old in terms of the amount of reset health we've put into it. The tactical wheeled vehicle fleet is very similar. And our readiness rates show it, both in theater, we consistently in the upper 80s to 90% on readiness rates of our wheeled fleet and the MRAPs, and in good shape in the helicopter fleet, 75 to 80%, very good. Similar back here at home. So that reset is central to the readiness of our Army now and in the out years.
So, sir, if I may add some comments to that. Instead, if we don't get the reset, a subset of OCO, of this strategic reset that we talk about, 2 to 3 years beyond the end of the war, it's going to take us longer to reset our force. Instead of a bell curve that you would see, you'll see a flat line. This will take us 5, 6, 7, 8 years to fix the readiness issues that we have in the Marine Corps. We might have to consider going to a tiered readiness because it will take us that long to have units that are capable and have the sufficient readiness rating that would be next in the batter's box to deploy. There'll be other hard. It would manifest itself in things like maybe lack of training because we won't have the equipment that we would need for training. That it would force us to make other hard choices related to the budget if we don't have that support there to reset our force.
When we look at the amount of dollars to do the reset, General, what are we talking about for the Army? General Mason.
Sir, if you're referring to the total amount,
yes.
At worst case, it could be up in the $15 to $16 billion range. I think it's going to be less than that. I don't know exactly where it's going to be, but I think it's significantly less than that. And the reason I say that is because, again, as we go through the force structure changes and we look at the requirements for units, and I talked about divestiture earlier, for example, wheeled vehicle fleets, we know we're going to take our vehicles down. We're going to take units out of the force structure. So we're not going to reset all that equipment, number one, because there won't be a requirement for it. Number two, some of that equipment will be unrepairable, so it'd be beyond repairable, so we won't repair that particular equipment. It'll all be based on our priorities. We're looking at it very closely. We're certainly going to reset the helicopter fleet. We need every one of those. We're going to reset our MRAPs. We're going to divest some MRAPs, but the vast majority of those MRAPs we'll need. Tanks and Bradleys, we've already done those. It's the radios, it's all that other equipment that we're really going to have to focus on and work through the eaches of what that requirement's going to be. So much less than $15 billion, but not exactly sure where it's going to fall in at this point.
Would it be fair to say that we're probably, even though it would be less than $15 billion, probably going to be at least $12 billion or more?
Sir, I hesitate to say, but I think it's probably in it could be in the 10 to 12, but sir, we got some work to do and really look through it. looking at what the equipment looks like as it comes out of theater is going to drive that number in many ways. And while we can do some inspection in theater, most of that equipment's out being used every day. So you really don't know till it gets back to the depot, till you get a full inspection on it, that you really get an idea of what it's going to cost to take care of that equipment.
We can't peg exactly how much, but can we get close on what years that we think probably the highest spike would be?
Sir, if the mandate to be generally done with combat operations by 2014, then if you add two more years to that, as we discussed. So I think the high point is going to be in the 15-16 time frame.
Good.
Our requirement is $3.2 billion. We continuously refine that. The Commandant is made it clear to us, just ask for what we need, and that's part of that refinement, continuous refinement. But it is 3.2, that's for that strategic reset post the war being over. We think our spike, a little different, we think it's going to be 14 and 15.
14 and 15?
Yes, sir.
Now, General Mason, you mentioned the importance for our commanders in opening up those boxes that are there and finding out what's in them. One of the boxes all of us have been reluctant to open is this box of sequestration, but we know it's the law right now, and we know based on the law it's kind of across the board cuts. Assuming that stays the law, assuming it's not changed, what does that do to your reset?
Sir, it significantly impacts it. If we don't get OCO, then we have to take it out of the base, it's devastating. It's catastrophic. We'll take significant risk with our swing forces. So we need to reset what's coming out of theater. So if we don't get those dollars through OCO, we'd have to go into the base, which means the forces that we might have to use for another contingency somewhere in the world, their readiness rate's going to go down. I guess I would equate it to, we're going to take 72,000 soldiers out of the Army, but we're going to take it over about a five-year period. It's going to be very deliberate. We're going to work our way through it. We're going to do the right things for our soldiers as they exit our great Army. If you go to sequestration, I think you're talking about taking 80,000 soldiers out in 1 year. I mean, that's the kind of scenario that could play itself out. You're talking rifts like we did at the end of Vietnam. I mean, those are the kinds of things that I think could be on the horizon. I hope they're not. I don't want to go there. But I think it's, as the Secretary of Defense has said, it'd be catastrophic.
General Panner?
Yes, sir. I think it would. It is so significant that we would have to relook our national military strategy. We would probably have to reduce our force a further 15 to 20,000 Marines.
General Panner, where would that put you in terms of total?
Well, that would, you back off 20,000 from 182, that puts you in our 1970s profile, which was not healthy at all. In fact, it was a hollow force, sir, if you remember then. We couldn't train then. I would see a similar thing because we couldn't afford the fuel to train. We couldn't afford the Class 5, the ammo to train. Very similar things, I would think, might be manifested if we have to go this. We would break faith with our Marines. We have a plan now to get down to the size that we need to be. It's based on voluntary mechanisms. We'd be forced, like the United States Army, to go to involuntary means, and we would consider breaking faith with our Marines and families. We would have to consider, as I mentioned before, tiered readiness, which we do not want to do. The inability to train, having sufficient equipment, having sufficient O&M, personnel shortages, it just would not position the Marine Corps to be the expeditionary force in readiness that the nation expects. Thank you.
I would offer one other thing, Chairman. The Chief's guidance to the Army is prevent, shape, and win. If you go to that kind of a scenario, the Army's ability to prevent war, deter an enemy, would be at risk. Our ability to shape with our allies and those potential enemies around the world, and then to win. Each one of those then is going to be, I think, at risk, and that's not a good situation.
Madeline, do you have any other questions?
I have no questions.
Okay. The gentleman from New Jersey, have any additional questions? If not, we want to thank you so much once again for your service. Thank you for this. It's an important record for us as we go into this markup that we need to do. We hope we're going to be able to hold those funds for you because we know how important it is for you to be ready, and we thank you for your time here today. And with that, let me just ask you, do either of you have anything else you'd like to add that we didn't ask or that you weren't able to have time to clarify?
No, sir. We appreciate the opportunity to answer your questions and to have this part of the record. Thank you.
Sir, only thing to add is it's an honor to be here and stand with our great congressional teammates, and I consider you teammates, and I can't think of any higher accolade to be a member of a team. So thanks. Good to be here, sir.
Thank you.
Ms. Bordeaux.
We're adjourned.
Mr. Rodney.